We're in 1 John chapter 5. Our goal is to finish the book next Wednesday, this Wednesday. I'll teach on 2 John, and then the Wednesday after that we'll be looking at 3 John. And so Wednesday after that we'll be looking at the book of Jude, and then the Wednesday after that, 4 Wednesdays from now, exactly 1 month's time, we're going to be looking at the book of Revelation. And so prepare yourself for that. I'll let y'all make a decision on how technical of an introduction you want. You want a basic introduction, you want a technical introduction, you want to explore all sorts of possibilities, all sorts of outcomes, or do you want some good stuff you can take home and just apply to your life? Dole's shaking his head at that one. He goes, anything that keeps Cody talking less, I'll take. I heard an amen. I don't disagree. I don't disagree at all. 1 John chapter 5, the chapter title again was Confidence in Victory. Verses 1 through 5 relate to those who have been born of God. Being born of God, chapter 5 verse 1, is the source of love. Those who believe that Jesus Christ is born of God, they're going to be loving to the brethren. And you see that in verses 2 and 3, that we're to be proving our love to our brethren. And that's a demonstration of us being born of God, being Christians in its true sense. And those who are born of God, those who are Christians, they're victorious, verses 4 and 5. They are participants in the faith, and the faith has overcome the world. The faith is the victory. And so as we move from there, some people ask, you know, what is the validity of the faith? The Gnostics would have been asking, what is the validity of the faith? And so as we look at verses 6 through 12, we're going to see the foundation of the faith. So if you've been taking notes, if you're making like an outline, verses 1 through 5 would be like the big one that you would make, and that would be born of God. 6 through 12, the foundation of faith would be the big two, the in your outline. You look at verses 6 to 8 first, we're going to see that Jesus is realized, he's made real, he's acknowledged by witnesses. He's realized by witnesses, verses 6 through 8. This is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. Not by the water only, but by water and blood. And the Spirit is the one who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. For there are three that agree, or that testify, the Spirit and the water and the blood, and these three agree. So verses 6 through 8, Jesus is realized by witnesses. Now, I'm using the ESV. Many of you here are using the King James. So there's going to be a variation in the text. In this specific section, verses 6 through 12, that you'll notice, and you would, if you're King James, stop me whenever we get there, and we'll have a brief explanation as to why your translation says one thing, my translation says another. Can't remember exactly where it is. Is it verse 8?
Verse
7, the King James, the Father, the Son, and the...
The Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost.
Yeah, okay. We'll get to that here, after we look at verse 6 in this whole section, then I'll speak to that. When we look in verse 6a, so the first portion, we'll call it that first whole sentence, it tells us that Jesus is the one who came by water and blood. I'll tell you, that took a little thinking to try and figure that out, to understand exactly what John is trying to say there. Is there anybody here who has an idea of what that would be saying? This is he who came by water and blood. You know, maybe you were doing some study about this section beforehand. Maybe you've read before and it kind of just made you scratch your head and look a little bit. but it's interesting. I think what I've kind of concluded it is right. I'm not exactly sure. If you have a disagreement, of course, please feel free to share that with me. If you have anything to add, go ahead. But whenever I look at the word came, this is he who came by water and blood. The word came, the Greek word is erkomai, which means to draw near. And so if we place to draw near into that sentence, this is he who drew near by water and blood, Jesus Christ. Well, who did he draw near to? Who did Jesus Christ draw near to? Jesus is God, right? And God lives in a spiritual place. We are men. We live in a physical place. And so God, Jesus, had to leave a spiritual place and come to a physical place, right? And so my understanding would be this is he who came, one who drew near. It would be him drawing near to man, drawing near to his creation. And it tells us here that he drew near by water and blood. Now, I believe this is referring to Jesus coming near to man, and he came near to them. Water, what do you think that signifies? Baptism. What does blood signify? Huh? Crucifixion, the shedding of his blood, right? So this is him. He drew near to man by water, by baptism, and by the shedding of his blood. Look at these scriptures with me real quick. Look here at Hebrews chapter 9. Let's look at verse 14. Actually, let's back up to verse 13. For if the blood of bulls and goats and the sprinkling of defiled persons with ashes of a heifer sanctify for the purification of the flesh, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from dead works to serve the living God? Therefore, he is the mediator of a new covenant, so that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance, since a death has occurred that redeems them from the transgressions committed under the first covenant. Verse 16, for where a will is involved, the death of the one who made it must be established. For a will takes effect only at death, since it is not in force as long as the one who made it is alive. Therefore, not even the first covenant was inaugurated without blood. For when every commandment of the law had been declared by Moses to all the people, he took the blood of calves and goats with water and scarlet wool and hyssop and sprinkled both the book itself and all the people, saying, "This is the blood of the covenant that God commanded for you." And in the same way, he sprinkled with the blood both the tent and all the vessels used in worship. Verse 22. Here is our highlight verse right here. Verse 22. Indeed, under the law, almost everything is purified with blood. And without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Jesus Christ came to draw men near. Was his mission. Luke 19 and verse 10, for the Son of Man came to seek and save that which is lost. You think about what is lost. In the parable of the lost sheep, the shepherd, he goes out and he finds the sheep, and he doesn't walk away at a distance and say, "Come on, come on." He picks the sheep up, he draws near to the sheep, and he carries them. So now Jesus has drawn near to us, and it's by the shedding of his blood. That's how we have the remission of sins. It's how we have forgiveness. That's how you and I are able to be in that fellowship with God and in good standing with him. Now, baptism works its way into the equation. Turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3, and let's look here at verses 18 to 21. 18 to 21. says, for Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh and made alive in the spirit. He'd offered his life, right? He offered his life. He shed his blood, Hebrews 9:22. Look here, verse 19, in which he went to proclaim to the spirits in prison, because they formerly did not obey, when God's patience waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were brought safely through water. Here's where water works itself in this equation. Verse 21, baptism which corresponds to this. What does baptism correspond to? Salvation. It corresponds to, you back up to verse 18 again, being brought near, that he might bring us to God. Baptism, which corresponds to this, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so it tells us that Jesus, going back to 1 John 5, tells us that he had come, he drew near to man by water and blood, baptism, salvation, and ultimately saying is he drew near by means of sacrifice, and now he stays near by way of our faithfulness. By way of our faithfulness. Verses 6 through 8, whenever you continue in them, you have mentioning of three different witnesses. I'll begin with what the ESV says, and I'll look at the King James. The ESV brings up spirit, the spirit, the water, and the blood, as all three being witnesses. The word witness here, or those who convey a testimony, is the Greek word martyreo. Martyreo, which sounds like what English word? Martyreo. Martyr. Martyr. And a martyr is someone who testifies and has died because of their testimony. And so you have the Spirit bearing a witness of him. How did the Spirit bear witness of Jesus Christ? Does the Spirit speak? It's scriptures. John chapter 5 and verse 39. Jesus laid down five witnesses to his ministry, to the validity of his ministry. He mentioned himself, he mentioned the Father, he mentioned the Spirit. I'll begin with that. He mentioned the Spirit. And how would the Spirit, the scriptures, be a witness? Well, you look at the prophecies of the Old Testament. Jesus fulfilled those. You look at the promises of the Old Testament. The Father, God, he told Israel, he said, I'm sending to you a messenger. And then, in John chapter 5, Jesus spoke of two more witnesses. So you have the Father as a witness, you have Jesus as a witness, or his works as a witness. You have the scriptures with the Spirit as a witness. Then you have John the Baptizer being named as a witness, and Moses being named as a witness. Moses and John the Baptizer serve in the function of a witness, or as a witness, because they were those who were under the operation of the Holy Spirit. You see in 2 Peter chapter 1, in verses 20 and 21, Peter talks about inspiration. He says, knowing this first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. Peter is saying, this stuff is not made up, and then God puts a stamp of approval on it. This is God informing the messenger. This is what you will say. Whenever a king sends delegation, he doesn't tell the ambassador, go tell him whatever, and whatever you say, I'll just go with that. The king doesn't do that. The king says, this is what you'll say, this is what you'll send, and that's what these men do. Verse 21, for no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. This is how the Holy Spirit provides a witness, a testimony to Jesus Christ and to the faith. The water and the blood bore witness, being the mode and the source of salvation, and these three are in agreement. Together they show that man can live eternally in heaven by closeness to Christ. The Spirit shows truth, water shows admission, and the blood shows forgiveness, atoning. Now, I'll speak to what I know about the King James variation and the ESV variation. You'll find the same variation in the New King James. The New King James is going to use what the King James says, and the American Standard Version. The American Standard Version is going to speak to the water, the blood, and the Spirit being those which testify. It's not going to mention the Father. The difference comes in the source of those translations. The American Standard, the ESV, use a separate set of manuscripts, which are believed to be more recent in their dating, whereas the King James and New King James use the Textus Receptus. Nothing wrong with the Textus Receptus. There are many many copies of the Textus Receptus that can be found. Many copies of it, manuscripts that would validify the Textus Receptus. It is it obviously, if the King James was translated in 1601, completed in 1611, and is the first English Bible that includes the Old Testament and the New Testament. Obviously, we're talking about manuscripts that come from the earliest datings, whereas American Standard and the ESV come from the latter dating. Some people have been open to admit that perhaps what you have taken place in the King James is a scribal interjection. Scribal interjection. I'll give you a scenario. Acts chapter 8 and verse 37. Many who I know who use the King James, some who we would maybe say, not that scholarship means anything, but some who we might say are of a scholarly background, they look at Acts 8, verse 37, these are King James users, and say, okay, that seems like scribal interjection, which really is just whenever a scribe, I mean, the Catholic Church and those were the ones copying the manuscripts for a good period of time. And so scribal interjection really just refers to a guy who was writing the scripture, right, taking the copy, translating the copy, producing the copy of the copy, and just decided to interject his thought. Not that those thoughts are wrong. Do the Father, the Son, the Spirit all agree and testify to Jesus as the foundation of the faith? Yes, of course. Jesus hit on that in John chapter 5. So maybe that's the reason why you have a possible interjection there. I mean, I wasn't there when this was written, so I can't tell you which one's original, right? I can't tell you which one's more correct than the other. All I can do is really simply say this is why you have the difference. It's just scribal interjection, perhaps, on one part or the other. Any questions about that?
I had just, you can tell there's some differentiation there between them all, but I want to get hung up on that in and of itself rather than just looking at what is trying to be said.
Yep. Let's look here at verses 9 and 10. Again, the foundation of faith is being brought up here. Jesus Christ has realized by witnesses. And then verses 9 and 10, you have the witness of God and the witness of men. Verses 9 and 10, if we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God is greater. For this is the testimony of God that has been born concerning his Son. Whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. Whoever does not believe, God has made him a liar, because he has not... Whoever does not believe, God has made him a liar. Not that God has made him a liar. I think it's the way Whoever does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed in the testimony that God has borne concerning his son. Verse 9, you have the witness of the greater over the witness of the lesser. Here is maybe the application here. Maybe this is an approach to the argument of logic. And you need to listen from the greater source rather than a lesser source. And the point here is, you've already believed in a lesser source, right? These people, John's writing to them because he knows they listen to me. John says, they listen to me. They know I'm trustworthy. If you can believe what I have to say about Jesus Christ, you certainly need to believe what Jesus reveals about himself, what the Father reveals about himself, about Jesus Christ, and what the Spirit has revealed about Jesus Christ. The Godhead, God, so in verse 9, I mean, you go back to the King James, ESV variation there. Verse 9, the King James, or the ESV kind of brings it back together. The testimony of God, the Godhead, bears witness and gives testimony to the truths of Jesus Christ, saving work. Saving work. Verse 10, you have the fact of the testimony that if you don't believe it, you're making God a liar. Again, to believe in Jesus Christ as the Son of God is to have God abide in you, to abide in truth, and to continuously cease from sin, to continually cleanse yourself, to purify your way, and so forth. Live for him. Such a one who does this has the testimony in him. To abide in Jesus is to believe that Jesus is the Son of God and to understand that eternal life is through him alone. And again, the Holy Spirit is truth, 1 John chapter 5 and verse 7. And God is of truth with no darkness at all, 1 John 1. And verse 5, and so as we're talking about one making God a liar, it comes down to this. The one who rejects the soul-saving power of Jesus Christ, rejects that is through baptism, rejects the blood of Christ that was shed, has rejected the witness, the testimony of the Godhead, and thereby makes God a liar. This is the spirit of the Antichrist. This is someone who's against Christ. They have listened to the witnesses, the valid witnesses, and they said, it's not enough for me. And so they're
not making God a liar. They're not calling that, but
right.
For me, reading this, I don't know, maybe a little off, but I see it the other way around. With all that God has done and said, anybody that speaks otherwise, God's made that position, stance and position, a liar, because it's not true.
Yeah.
And it's falsehood. I don't know. Yeah, if you're not going to believe all that I said, you know, anything you do or say is going to be a lie because God's saying it is true. They could be calling him a liar in that sense.
Right.
Doesn't mean it's a,
it doesn't mean that God
yes.
shifts into a position of, now he's the liar.
Because I say yes. something.
Yeah.
Right.
Look here at verses 11 and 12. 11 and 12, life is in the Son. Verses 11 and 12. And this is the testimony that God gave us eternal life. And this life is in his Son. Whoever has the life, has the Son, has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. So verse 11, life is in the Son. Think about this. When Jesus spoke to the Samaritan woman at Jacob's well, he explained to her that he could offer her living water, John 4 and verse 10. The living water would cause her to never thirst, but that water would spring up. That well of water would spring up into eternal life, John 4 and verse 14. That water, which is being mentioned there, was originally mentioned by the prophet Isaiah, in Isaiah 55 and verse 1. It was referred to again by Isaiah as the well of salvation, Isaiah 12 and verse 3. And then John would write of it again in Revelation chapter 21 and verse 6, as well as Revelation 22 and verse 1. Now, as we consider that, that salvation that would be offered, or not the salvation that would be offered, but the life that would be offered, we need to take note again that it's eternal life, it is salvation. And this is what God gives to us who have been born of Him, those who have changed that position, right? There's a difference between those born of God, they don't sin, they don't convert, they don't continue sinning, and those who are children of Satan, they continue sinning. They go on sinning. And so if you think about life being given to the one who has the Son, it's kind of like a statement of condition. If you walk in thus ways, you will have eternal life. And this is something of confidence. This is something of confidence. If we look here at verses 13 to 21, this would be our big three. If you're making an outline, the big three, the confidence of the faith, verses 13 to 21. Verses 13 through 15, you have confidence in eternal life. Confidence in eternal life. He says, I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God that you may know that you have eternal life. And this is the confidence that we have toward Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. And if we know that He hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the request that we have asked of Him. These things are written for a reason. These things are written so that we can know that we have salvation. These things which John is writing, written so that we can know we have salvation. The Gnostic said, you can't know if you have salvation. John saying that is absolute foolishness. You can certainly know. These things are written so that we can be confident, so that you can have confidence towards Him. The Gnostic would say, if you are saved, you should be confident in that salvation, because again, how do you know? John says, you can surely be confident. You can surely be confident. You think about, Jesus emphasized that we can be confident about His promises. Paul emphasized that we can be confident about the Lord's promises. He's going to be true and faithful to those things. John writes again so that we can be sure, so that we can navigate, so that we can follow, so that we can have fellowship. And he writes so that we can be trusting. If you think about prayer here, why would you talk to a God that you don't know is going to save you, right? Why would you ask Him anything? You can trust Him. You can trust Him. And John's trying to emphasize that here in this letter. You can trust Him. You can talk to Him. Look here at verses 16 and 17. 16 and 17, you have confidence in overcoming sin. If anyone sees his brother committing a sin not leading to death, he shall ask, and God will give him life. To those who commit sins that do not lead to death, there is sin that leads to death. I do not say that one should pray for that. All wrongdoing is sin. There is sin that does not lead to death. How do we pray for a sinning brother? How do we pray for a sinning brother? This is the part where I talk to this.
Wait a minute.
How do you pray for a sinning brother?
You pray for people that you can overcome while you're doing them all. Word that touch your heart, or someone that might have an influence to help you change what he's doing wrong. There's many ways you have, there's several ways you have, but you can be corrected to change. Part of changing what he's doing, he can be the light of God.
Yeah.
And also pray that as you reach out to them and through scripture and encouragement that the things that are confused specifically are done will be fruitful in helping them with that as well.
Any others? I mean, that basically covers what I put down in my notes. But I was going to see if anybody else had any other input on how to pray for a brother who is insane. Again, I agree with Roger. You pray. They can be led away from the temptations. Maybe you pray that they'll have an open mind to trust you as a brother in Christ, to bear with them and to hold them up. Maybe you would pray that they would be willing to seek the congregation's help, whatever the issue might be. But John, you know, John says you pray for this. You pray that this happens. You pray for this brother who's in sin. But he talks about a sin that leads to death that you do not pray for. Any takers on that? I'll tell you, I definitely don't know with 100% confidence, but I do have an idea that I'll share. But I'll ask if anybody else has any thought on that. Sin leading to death. He says, you do not pray for that.
Pray if you're too bad.
Mark chapter 3.
You also have the sin that's unrepented of and is continued in.
Okay.
Versus that is not a continual sin. Put away.
All right. So I'm going to take your thought and your thought and I'll put them together. Okay. So you think about Mark chapter 3, what happened there? Jesus healed a man on the Sabbath, and they said that the Lord is of Beelzebub. And so you can look at it and say, okay, so the sin leading to death is blaspheming the name of the Lord. True, they're blaspheming the name of the Lord. But deeper than that, they had just seen Jesus' deity proven. And yet they go on to accuse him and later they go on to crucify him. I believe, this is my thought here, as we talk about sin leading to death, we're talking about deliberate sin. We're talking about willful sin. You know, sometimes we sin willfully. Sometimes we might have the understanding of, I can get away with this. But most of the time we sin unintentionally, right? Maybe there's a part of the former self that comes out for a moment. And I think usually whenever that happens, we're pretty apt to say, I can't believe that happened. Let me go and deal with this. But this is talking about someone who just, they might as well start shaking their fist at God because they really don't care. They really don't care. I don't care what God says about this. This is deliberate sin. This is going on. I think a scripture provides maybe a little bit of input to this is 2 Peter chapter 2. And verses 20 to 22, Peter was talking about false teachers. False teachers. And you remember when we talked about these false teachers, there were those, 2 Peter 2 and verse 10, who are bold and willful. They do not tremble as they blaspheme the glorious one. They don't care. Verses 20 to 22, for if, after they have escaped the defilements of the world through the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, you're talking about someone who's saved. They are again entangled in them and overcome. They're back into the passions. They're overcome by the passions. They're lost. They've fallen away. The state has become worse for them than the first. For it would have been better that they never had known the way of righteousness than after knowing it, turn back from the holy commandment delivered to them. What the true proverb says has happened to them. The dog returns to its own vomit, and the sow, after washing herself, returns to wallow in the mire. This is talking about the teacher. This is someone who knows the truth. These are teachers. They've taught the truth. They've studied the truth. And they say, you know what? I'm just going to live a different lifestyle. I'm going to do something else. I'm going to do what I want. John says, don't pray for this. Not don't pray that it doesn't happen. Obviously, of course, we need to be praying that it doesn't happen. Pray for those who teach. Pray for those who preach. Pray for those who lead as elders. They continue steadfast forward, and they help you to move on forward and to look to God's Word as a source of growth. But he's saying that you don't pray for this individual, which seems maybe a little bit weird. You pray for a brother who sinned, but you don't pray for a brother who's deliberately sinned. You don't pray for a brother who has gone his own course. Yep.
You do pray for that individual. You pray that he repents from what he's doing. Yeah, he may have been a strong Christian for years like that, but he's wandered off. And he's in sin. Mm-hmm. He knows he's in sin. You pray for that individual, he comes back, and he repents from what he's doing. So I have trouble understanding what's all being said here myself, but I don't know if individuals should pray for. But the work of the sinner needs the truth.
Right.
It may be that we're not praying for that sin to be forgiven.
Yep.
So that might be the.
That's what I was going to get at.
Okay.
I was kind of asking a prodding question.
Pause and trouble.
You lead me on.
Stir in the pot a little bit.
We never pray for the sin itself, we pray for the soul of the individual sensing. Did I say that right?
Maybe in this situation. Yes. Not that I think so. In this situation, they're saying here, yes, you could pray for the things being done for them, pray that their heart would be tender, open, maybe, but there's a certain peace that, you know, the way it warns and everything, we've got to be careful with God and really respect who He is, what He is, and while we hope the best for each other, if somebody draws a line and in strict opposition to Him, there's other places in the Scripture where, you know, God says, "Don't." You know, even when Nadab and Abihu were killed for improper worship, yeah, He was told to hold his peace.
Yeah.
You know, you don't, you know,
very don't even weep for them.
That's right. Don't even weep for them. And so there's that, again, like I said, there's that side of God that we have to really respect.
We don't know the individual's heart anyway.
Right.
We still pray, but God knows the heart.
Right.
God knows if it's a penitent or not. We still pray for the individual. It does change. If he changed, we may not know that. God will determine whether I don't forgive the sin or not. We pray for an individual. We don't do the forgiving. God does. And God knows the heart of the individual we're praying for.
Right. I think maybe. Yeah, go ahead.
No, I agree. We can pray for things, but if they won't turn, I guess that's where we're at. Not like that's what we're talking about here.
Right.
Somebody who's not going to, because they're talking about a brother. So we're talking about somebody who already knows the truth. They're potentially wandering off. And for me, I take away that maybe it's already been addressed. I don't know. But they're going to keep marching against, contrary to God.
Right.
Is it in the book
to
plan for?
We can pray that.
How many times do we forget? How many times do you? 70 times 70?
It's not for us to forgive, though.
No, we're not. I'm not saying we forgive God. God knows the heart, and God knows the forgiveness. When we pray for the individual, I don't care how far he goes down the road, I think we need to pray for him that he gets off that road and turns back. He does, you know, if he does or doesn't, then that's between him and God.
Right. I guess I think there's a difference here in that but you can't pray for his sin.
No, I'm not praying for his sin. I'm praying for his soul.
No, I understand that. We're talking about the sins, because if there's a sin unto death, I don't know if that's where it needs to be. It's just there is a thing telling us here
There might be a little bit of a modifier going on here. Right. In verse 16, as far as the term brother, I mean, perhaps the term brother is being used specifically to the one who is committing a sin not leading to death, whereas there is an individual who's committing a sin leading to death, but he might not exactly be your brother. Maybe this might provide some insight. Again, 16 and 17, these are difficult passages of Scripture. These things are very difficult at times to understand. I wish so deeply that we could just sit down and ask John, what does this mean, right? But verse 16 and 17 kind of makes me think of, there's a preacher, I know him, some of you might know him, but a couple years ago, a denominational teacher had passed away. This guy wrote a lot of books. This preacher liked his books. He claims that he gained a lot of wisdom from this denominational teacher. And on Facebook, he had posted something to the effect of, "May God have mercy on his soul." Maybe that is what we're talking about there. Because that denominational teacher deserves no mercy on his soul, right? After all the damage he had done, all the soul winning he'd done for Satan, he deserved no mercy for his soul. And so maybe if you take that kind of application, you have the treatment or the delightful image of treatment towards the denominational teacher kind of contribute or try to place that in verses 16 and 17. Maybe John's writing specifically to those who are dealing with this Gnostic problem. He's saying, your brother's in sin, you pray for your brother. You pray that they come. You pray that they follow, that they walk in the light as they're to be walking in the light. But the Gnostic teacher out there, you don't pray that God has mercy on them, right? Whenever you're praying for your brother who's in sin, a lot of times what you're praying for is that God be merciful and allot him more time, right? Because God could, I don't know, again, exactly if God's like, you're up, you're out of time. Obviously, he's done that before, right? Nadab and Abihu. So you might be praying to God, God be merciful with him, open his heart so that we can deal with the hardness of his heart and we can bring him back. Right? That's a brother. But, I mean, these people certainly knew these Gnostic teachers, right? I mean, you could be talking about, John could be writing to a woman whose husband is a Gnostic teacher. And he's saying, you don't pray. May God be merciful to them in the judgment. Yeah?
The word death, are we talking about physical death or spiritual death?
I've heard it both ways. I've heard people talk about the spiritual death.
All sin is the spiritual death.
Right.
And not all sin is the physical death.
Right. That's true. I've heard people use this passage with the Mormons.
Go back to what maybe like you said, just probably what I comment. An individual, even a brother, there's a mass murder.
Yes.
He deserved grace away from us. He deserved mercy.
Now,
of course, no. He doesn't. And that would be his physical death. Maybe we're talking about he certainly that he.
Yeah, I think so. I think it does have a lot more to do with physical death. It's still kind of tricky to understand, even thinking about it through kind of the end understanding of it being a physical death, right? It's still a little difficult, something chewing on, thinking over. Tell you, I tried to prepare for verses 16 and 17 as best as I could. I'll tell you, maybe I went a little longer than last Bible class and give myself a little bit more time for this. But yeah, verses 16 and 17, very difficult. Doyle just looked at the clock. It's all right. We've got three.
I didn't know what you meant.
We got about four more verses, and this is going to be quick, right? It's not anything long. Verses 18 through 20, let's look here. So we can talk about confidence in the faith. We have confidence in escaping sin, verses 18 through 20. We know that everyone who has been born of God does not keep on sinning, but he who was born of God protects him, and the evil one does not touch him. Let me touch on that. Verse 18, we're protected by God. We're protected by God. In John chapter 10, Jesus spoke of himself as the good shepherd. The good shepherd which lays his life down for the sheep. He even spoke about how we are in the Father's hand. And there is nothing exterior that could come in and pluck us out. As long as the Lord is our shepherd, right? And we have the choice. Do we make him our shepherd or do we not? Do we wander off as lost sheep or do we stay with the flock? So long as we're choosing to stay with the flock, there's not going to be a sheep wrangler come up, lower his hands over the fence, and run away with us, right? It's going to take a lot more than that to take away God's people from his protection. And so John's writing about that because that's a concern of people. That's a deep concern of people. I mean, you think about it, verses 5 through 7, 1 John chapter 1, verses 5 through 7, so many people at one time had walked around thinking that 1 John chapter 1, verses 5 through 7, I'm not just saying as a traditional view, but maybe as a personal view, maybe you thought about this a time or two, but 1 John chapter 5 through 7, you know, as we walk in the light, as he's in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of the Son, Jesus Christ, cleanses us from all wrong, from all wrongdoing, from all sin. A lot of people thought that moment that I sinned, boom, out of fellowship with God. I don't know, right? But it doesn't seem that easy. It doesn't seem that easy. And verse 18, chapter 5, verse 18 kind of makes me think that. It doesn't seem that easy. And we're just cut off by the string. Does that mean that we continue in sin? Grace may abound, Romans 6 and verse 1, absolutely not. By no means. God forbid. But I don't know exactly where the chopping point is. All I know is I don't want to be anywhere near the chopping point.
It's similar to the congregations mentioned in Revelation.
Yep.
They had things that were wrong. Now they're told to get them cleaned up.
Yeah.
You know, they're brought out. And I think in verse 18, the key is the two words, keepeth himself. The child of God is going to be at least striving to keep things cleaned up.
Right.
It doesn't mean that we're not going to stumble from time to time and everything else. Because God knows our attitude toward him. He knows our intentions. And he sees that part of us that we keep shadowed probably from the majority of those around us in the world especially. But God can see and he knows it. But I agree. Now, when we sin, how do we deal with it? All of those things come into play.
Yep.
Because like it says right here, we know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not, but he that is begotten of God keepeth himself, and that wicked one touch him not. Just that focus of keeping yourself, be active about that, mindful, conscientious, trying to keep ourselves square with the Father.
Look here, verse 19. He says, we know that we are from God, and the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. Confidence in escaping sin, we can be confident because we're in his hands. We're under his control. What's the song? Hold to his hand, hold to God's unchanging hand. And we do that, 1 John 5 and verse 4, and overcome. You gain the victory. Look here at verse 20. Confidence in escaping sin. Why? because he gives us the understanding to resist sin. Look here. And we know that the Son of God has come and given us understanding so that we may know him who is true. And we are in him who is true, in his Son Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life. Again, so many people. John's writing to a crowd of people who were worried. Can I just fall away against my own doing? Is Satan going to overcome me no matter what? Is there really no opposition that I could really put up? And then you got the Gnostics coming in saying, well, you can't even know if any of this stuff is true. La-ti-da. And John has to come in and reassure them. No, he's giving you understanding. This is the understanding. Psalm 9 and verse 7, the scriptures, this right here, the word of God, makes the simple wise. This is the guide. Psalm 119 and verse 105, thy word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. He lights up our way. He gives us an understanding, and we can hang our hat on that. We can know salvation. We can know fellowship with God. Now, verse 21, this is the key to keeping confidence. You want to be confident in overcoming the world? You want to be confident in having fellowship with God? This is the key. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. That's the key. Keep yourself from idols. Idols are those things which come between you and God. Things which come between you and the faith. Now, what he's talking about here, keep yourself from idols. I mean, there's a lot that could be thrown around as far as the understanding of this. Are these physical idols? Certainly could be, right? Are these mental idols? Covetousness? Covetousness is a sin of the mind, right? It's not a sin of the hands. Covetousness says, I really like Doyle's little puffy sweater there. I really like how it says Techstar on the front. I think I'm going to get that. You know what? Last time I checked, Jennifer does this at 3 o'clock. Doyle is at work at this time. Maybe I can get into their home and I can get that sweater, right? It's a sin of the mind, right? Thievery, that's a sin of the hands. And covetousness, Colossians chapter 3, verse 4 or verse 6, covetousness is idolatry. You're holding possessions high in the place of, I will do anything to attain. This idols could be things made with hands, things of the mind. Could be human reasoning. Human reasoning. John is writing this letter, 1 John, to refute human reasoning. Human reasoning is going around telling people you can't know God. Human reasoning is going around saying if the flesh is bad, the spirit is good, then Jesus, being spirit, could not occupy the flesh, and so therefore he could never get on the cross, he could never die for the sins of man, and so therefore there is no salvation, and if there is salvation, how can you really be sure? I mean, these people are just throwing around all kinds of hypotheticals, all sorts of questions, raising a question to every bit of truth, and John is saying, you know, keep yourself away from those things. Human reasoning sometimes is, not sometimes, human reasoning all the time is flawed. Existentialist? Why would you ever hang your head on existentialism? It's just foolishness, absolute foolishness. But maybe another idea here is that these idols are mistaken images of Christ. Mistaken images of Christ, meaning they take Christ and they form him into something he's not. The church in Corinth had that problem, right? They continued in sin. They were a sinful people. They thought that grace would abound. Why? Because they looked at Jesus Christ, their liberator, and said, he's going to free us from all sin, all wrongdoing. No, he's not. He's going to free you. He's going to give you, he's going to lay forth expectations that you walk with him, that you walk in the light. If you sin and you're sorry, you're repentant, he'll forgive you. But if you go on sinning, he's not going to say, you know, just keep throwing it on my tab, man. Keep throwing it on my tab. No, it's not what Jesus Christ does. And maybe that's what they were dealing with here. And maybe that's what the Gnostics were preaching, this whole different idea about God. And you look at where modern Gnosticism is. I think if you were to go back to the first video on 1 John, you'd be able to read what I brought up about modern Gnosticism. I looked at a Gnostic sanctuary website. There's a Gnostic sanctuary in California, kind of makes sense. But if you're to look at it, I mean, it's just all sorts of wackiness, and everything is open to your own interpretation.
Go ahead.
Okay. Well, that concludes 1 John. So we had 5 chapters. This covered a good deal of time. So real quick, I'm going to just try to put a little bow on it. All right, I'm going to wrap it all together, put a bow on it. When John wrote this letter, he's pointing out 4 things to the Christian. Chapter 1, he's pointing out that fellowship with God requires continual practice. Chapter 2, he's pointing out that fellowship with God is attained through Christ alone. Chapters 3 and 4, John is pointing out that fellowship with God is proven by obedience. In chapter 5, John is pointing out that fellowship with God is something to hold to in confidence. If we make these things truths, or if we take these truths, rather, and apply them daily, we walk daily, we appreciate daily, we obey daily, we trust daily, we'll do all right. We'll be victorious, 1 John 5. Any questions, comments about the book of 1 John?
Verse 21, again, we're going to keep yourself from idols. This is what the lesson was this morning. We can't let anything come first.
I remember the lesson this morning.
Yeah. No, that we can't let anything else place itself above God, Christ, His Word, the